أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the time of the Messenger of Allah, there was a young princess from Habasha. The word Habasha literally means black. Habasha is the name of 7th century Kush, which extended from Yemen to northeast Africa. Habashan people are known today as Abyssinian, Ethiopian, and Eritrean. The young princess from Habasha was kidnapped at the age of 11 and was intended for sale on the slave market. Prophet Muhammad adopted her instead. It was common practice in the early days of Islam for a believer to purchase a captive in bondage and set them free. Prophet Muhammad, once an orphan himself, adopted, educated, and raised children to positions of power in the Islamic State. The pagan Arabs, however, did not agree with this practice because it made their former slaves superior to them on every level of piety and social status. To be raised in the house of the Messenger of Allah was to be raised in a house that was blessed and purified by Allah. To be raised in the house of the Messenger of Allah was to become a beacon of light. And this is what became of the young black princess from Habasha. She was an Islamic scholar who knew the inner meanings of the Holy Quran, and Prophet Muhammad named her Fizza. Hazrat Fizza was predestined to reflect the light of the Ahlul Bayt. The word Fizza is Quranic Arabic for silver. In Surah Al-Insan, the attribute of Fizza is the attribute of silver, which is the best known reflector of visible light. Metaphysically, it means that Fizza is the best known reflector of spiritual light. Raised by Fatima Zahra, who is known throughout the Islamic and Christian worlds as the Lady of Light. The name Fizza translates into silver. Silver metal is brilliant, eye-catching, and attractive. It has the highest electric and thermal conductivity of all metals. Silver remains stable in pure air and water. The house of the Messenger of Allah was a pure environment. Allah says in the Holy Quran that He purifies the members of this household with the thorough purification. It was this environment which kept Fizza in her natural state as a pure and untarnished princess. Fizza was cultivated in the environment of Ahlul Bayt and blossomed into the most knowledgeable and most honorable black queen of Islam. For this reason, she is known as Malika Habasha, which means Abyssinian, Ethiopian, or more literally, the Black Queen. Fizza mastered the Quran to such a degree that she could give any answer to any question by reciting a verse from the Quran. She could easily hold a conversation by reciting the Holy Quran, and she is reported to have spoken a language which consisted of the Quran and nothing but the Quran. Princess Fizza was not an average princess. She was raised in the house of the descendants of Abraham. Princess Fizza was raised with the chiefs of the youths in paradise, Hassan and Hussein, the beloved grandsons of the Prophet of Allah. She was raised in the home of the manifesting Imam, Ali ibn Abi Talib. Fatima Zahra, daughter of the Holy Prophet, on her deathbed, said to Imam Ali, "I loved Fizza like my daughter." Hazrat Fizza had the honor of taking part in the 3-day fast. Once, when Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein fell sick, the Holy Prophet suggested that Imam Ali and Bibi Fatima make a vow to fast for 3 days until the children recovered. When the children were better, Imam Ali, Hazrat Fatima, Imam Hassan, Imam Hussein, and Hazrat Fizza all fasted to fulfill the vow. However, on each of the 3 days, when they sat to break their fast, a hungry person called at their door. The first said he was poor, the second said he was an orphan, and the third said he was a freed captive. Each time, the big-hearted members of the house, including Bibi Fizza, gave away their food and broke their fast with water. Allah has praised this selfless act in the Quran on many occasions. Hazrat Fizza remained with Ahlul Bayt and was present in the massacre which took place against the children of Prophet Muhammad in the land of Karbala. Hazrat Fizza was in the court of Yazid in her old age, exercising her authority as a black queen by calling her black brothers to take up arms against the oppressor. "You there," Yazid said, pointing in the direction of Imam Zainul Abidin. "Who is he, and why is he still alive?" Yazid shouted. Umar Saad, rising to his feet, bowed and said, "Your Majesty, this is Ali ibn al-Husayn. He is very sick and will die soon anyway. That is why we did not kill him." "I shall not let any son of Husayn live," shouted Yazid in a rage. He asked Shimmer to kill Imam Zainul Abidin. Seeing Shimmer advance towards them, Bibi Zainab stood in front of the Imam and said, "If you want to kill him, you will have to kill me first." Shimmer stepped forward to kill Bibi Zainab. At once, Hazrat Fizza stood in front of Bibi Zainab to protect her and said, "You will have to kill me first." Shimmer again moved forward to kill Hazrat Fizza. Hazrat Fizza turned to the Abyssinian slaves who were standing behind Yazid's throne with bare swords as his bodyguards and said, "O brothers from my native land, what has happened to your fraternal and communal feelings that you silently watched the queen of your country being molested in this manner? With your drawn swords, can't you offer protection to your aged princess from the lashes of this tyrant, who has been our tormentor throughout the march from Karbala to Damascus?" Hearing these words of Fizza, some of the slaves stepped forward and addressing Yazid, one of them said, "Your Majesty, ask Shimmer to hold his hands and not to use the lash on our Princess Fizza. If he does anything to her today, blood will flow like water in your court." Yazid was flabbergasted at this affront of his slaves. Drunk though he was, he had sense enough to realize that they were serious and meant what they said. The coward in him panicked at the sight of the bare swords glistening in the light of the chandeliers. He immediately shrieked a command to Shimmer, "Stay where you are, Shimmer, and do not budge an inch, otherwise I shall have your head chopped off." Then, turning to the slaves, with a wry smile, he said, "My good fellows, I know you are all so devoted and faithful to me, and always ready to protect and guard me. I shall not allow anything to be done to touch your sense of honor and your beloved princess." Yazid knew that the scene created by the slaves had humiliated him in the eyes of his courtiers and even the foreign emissaries, and the speeches later delivered by Imam Zainul Abidin and Lady Zainab shook him to the core. In order to protect his remaining honor and majesty, the humiliated Yazid gave all the stolen belongings of the Ahlul Bayt back to the Imam and sent the women and children back to Medina.